We're learning more about how President-elect Joe Biden may use his executive power to undo much of President Trump's agenda. Our Camila Montoya Galvez reports the Biden administration plans to make sweeping changes to the country's immigration policy. After he's sworn in January 20th, Mr. Biden plans to fully restore what's known as DACA. The policy provides legal protection to more than 600,000 undocumented immigrants brought to the U.S. as children. He'll also look to implement a 100-day freeze on deportations and to curb collateral arrests. That's when people who are not the targets of ICE operations are taken into custody anyway. At the southern border, Mr. Biden is pledging to end the Trump administration policy requiring people to wait in Mexico while their U.S. asylum cases are heard. Because so much of the Trump agenda was administered through executive actions, new executive actions in a Biden administration could undo those policies. That extends into the fight against climate change as well. The Washington Post reports the Biden administration is poised to enlist agencies across the federal government to help reduce emissions. That includes the Departments of Transportation, Agriculture, Treasury, and State, acknowledging the issue touches different aspects of American life. CBS News political contributor Lynda Tran joins me now. She's a Democratic strategist and partner at 270 Strategies. Welcome, Lynda. Great to see you again. So it remains to be seen how Georgia's two Senate runoffs will go, but I want to go ahead and play some sound from the president-elect on Tuesday being asked about working with Republicans who won't accept his victory. Let's listen to that.
How do you expect to work with Republicans if they won't even acknowledge you as president-elect?
They will. They will.
So, Lynda, how does he plan to convince Republicans to work on things like climate change or a $15 minimum wage?
Well, the good news, Elaine, is that climate change actually happens to be an issue where there already is a good deal of bipartisan consensus. In fact, in the Senate in particular, you have to look no further than the Senate Climate Solutions Caucus, which is co-chaired by Chris Coons and Mike Braun, the senator from Indiana, and includes a number of senators who actually just got narrowly reelected, including Susan Collins and Lindsey Graham. You know, this is a group of senators who, while they may not see eye to eye on a whole host of issues that are happening all around the country, they believe that climate change is an urgent and growing crisis. And there's certainly room to have that conversation and actually to use these folks as fellow organizers, frankly, on the issue moving forward. And then, as you said, Elaine, there's also a lot that the administration can do from the executive order or regulatory perspective as well. You know, when we think back to the Obama administration and fuel economy standards, for example, that was a regulatory collaboration between the Department of Transportation and the Environmental Protection Agency that did not involve Congress at all. So there's a lot that this incoming administration can do to make progress on that issue. When you circle back to the minimum wage, we also know that the vast majority of Americans believe that we ought to raise the minimum wage to $15 an hour. And the good news there is that a lot of the action is happening actually in the cities and states, as if there is no action on Capitol Hill, there's still progress to be made nationally.
Well, I think it's encouraging for Americans to hear that with respect to things like climate change, potentially there are places for cooperation, because it just doesn't seem, at least listening to some of the rhetoric, that there could be areas of commonality between the two parties here. So that's encouraging. Well, Lynda, we learned today that Republican Senator Dan Sullivan has won re-election in Alaska, giving Republicans 50 seats. Georgia still does have those two outstanding seats headed to a runoff. But does it look like Mr. Biden's overall agenda faces a tentative future in the Senate?
Well, you know, it depends on how you look at it. I think that the president-elect and the vice president-elect have made very clear that tops on their list of priorities is getting the coronavirus pandemic under control and, related to that, injecting some energy into the economy. And so that is definitely going to be a round-the-clock, every day of the week job for both of them as they step into the White House. And then, of course, as we've talked about, climate change is a high priority for him as well. And I do think that there are going to be a number of different opportunities for this incoming administration to find ways to make progress with the Senate, regardless of how the ultimate numbers break down.
Well, as we look ahead, I do want to take a moment to look back and analyze the election. New analysis from the Washington Post shows this shift over the past 4 years in majority non-white counties across the country. Now, you can see gains for Democrats in metro Atlanta and the big cities in Texas, but also losses in South Florida and the Rio Grande Valley. And I wonder, Lynda, what do you think happened there? What do you think the party needs to do to win back those voters?
You know, Elaine, I think that in a short way of summarizing it, we need to stop treating Latino voters as if they're a monolith. In fact, we should strike the term Latino voters from the lexicon altogether, because there are so many dramatic cultural and community differences between Mexican Americans, Venezuelans, Cuban Americans. In fact, folks may not know, and Cuban Americans make up a large proportion of the Latino electorate. In Florida, they tend to be very conservative, and anti-immigrant rhetoric actually speaks to a large proportion of that community. So there are big, big differences across the Latinx community that we definitely need to take into account in the way that we speak to issues that they care about. We also just need to be more broadly, much more consistent about how we're organizing, how we're engaging, and how often we are present in those communities that we know we then want to turn out to support Democrats come election season.
Yeah, it's so interesting you say that, because I want to dig into another group that is definitely not a monolith, no group is, but the fastest growing eligible group of eligible voters in the country is Americans who trace their roots to Asia or the Pacific Islands. So in political shorthand, they're often referred to as AAPI voters, Asian American Pacific Islander. They went for Joe Biden 61% to 34%. That's 11 points worse than Hillary Clinton's margin 4 years ago. Now, again, this is an incredibly diverse group, as is the Latino group. But what do you think actually drove this shift among AAPI voters?
Well, you know, Elaine, we also set certain expectations early on once Kamala Harris was part of the national ticket. We just assumed that Asian Americans, AAPI voters, were going to come out in greater numbers to support the Biden-Harris ticket. And those differences among groups within the AAPI electorate bore out in this cycle just as they have in past cycles. So Indian Americans often support Democrats at greater proportions, and they did so again this cycle. And Vietnamese Americans, my own heritage, tend to support Republicans more. And I think the big factor was, while we thought that statements like the Kung Flu virus and other kind of racist terms that the Trump campaign and Trump administration used would turn folks off, actually, the early numbers that we see show that Donald Trump didn't lose a great deal of support among that base within the Asian American electorate. And so, you know, I think that this is another area where, again, we need to treat different communities with the individual approach, understanding their individual needs. And then we also just need to show up earlier. You know, often with Asian American voters in particular, ads and community outreach does not begin until quite late in the campaign cycle, the last month or two. And we just can't afford to keep doing that.
Yeah, it just raises the question of whether or not there need to be sort of different ways of talking about people who happen to fall in these groups. It shows, as you said, the diversity within ideologically as well. Overall, we saw Democrats largely limit their campaign travel because of the pandemic, and that appeared to work well enough to win for Joe Biden, but not for the House Democrats, who lost their seats. So, Lynda, what lessons do you think can be taken away from that?
Well, you know, Elaine, there are some positives for sure, right? The fact that everyone is in this virtual pandemic environment meant that people were answering their telephones, they were responding to text messages, and for those who wanted to volunteer and take part in this historic election, it was just all the more easy for them to do so, to get involved in, you know, learning how to be a texting volunteer, a digital team volunteer, or to make those phone bank calls from home. So there were certainly upsides for the Biden team in terms of volunteer engagement. I think the bigger challenge for House candidates and for Senate candidates as well was that in an environment where you're not allowed to be out on the doors or to have these big events where you can meet voters face to face, if you don't have incredibly high name ID and brand ID the way that Joe Biden has because of his, you know, nearly five decades of public service, that means that voters don't necessarily have a clear sense of who you are, what you're about, nor do they feel a relationship with you. And I think that's where the disconnect really happened all around the country.
All right, Lynda Tran, I could talk to you all day, but we are out of time. Thank you so much. Great to see you.
Thanks, Elaine.